अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स साधु सं I was just checking for the light. So we have a sutta which is called from Samyutta. Sorry, this is Sutta Nipata. This is Sutta 14, Dhammika Sutta. So over here, lay people are coming to Buddha and asking about monks as well as lay people. So I'll first share the file in the chat, and then you can follow it along with me. So this is a click here to rejoin. I am unable to share the file directly, so I have also uploaded it on the Google Drive. So I'll share that link. So you can download this and kind of follow along with me. Thus have I heard on one occasion. The Blessed One was dwelling at Savati in Jetha's grove, Anatha Pindika's park. Then the lay follower Dhammika, together with 500 lay followers, approached the Blessed One, paid homage to him, and sat down to one side. Seated to one side, the lay follower Dhammika addressed the Blessed One in verses. So one of the things we kind of see in the suttas is that the number 5,000 or 1,000. So these are a kind of approximate number. They are not exact numbers kind of given in the suttas. It feels like 5,000, it feels like 1,000, it feels like 1,500. So those numbers are kind of disputed by the scholars, but it is also seen in modern day India when we kind of describe the crowds, you know, that there were tens of millions of people who had shown up. And that is a kind of a obvious exaggeration. It's a kind of a way of conveying the feeling of the large number of crowds. So that is the lay follower comes with a large number of people. I ask you, Gautama, one of broad wisdom, how does a good disciple act, whether one who has gone from home to homelessness or those lay followers who live at home? For you know the course, the destination of the world together with its devas. That means the Buddha has the divine eye. There is none equal to you, one who shows us a subtle meaning, for they say you are the excellent Buddha. Having directly experienced all knowledge, you reveal the Dhamma. So this is also a very important statement, which is that you directly knowing, directly experienced all knowledge, you reveal the Dhamma. That means that the knowledge which the Buddha has accumulated is a first-hand knowledge. It's not through logic, or it's not through contemplation. It's not through thinking, but by practice and looking at the mind, he has a first-hand knowledge of what is happening. Your coverings are removed. You are the universal eye. Stainless, you shine radiantly in all the world. Coverings are removed means there are no kind of hidden secrets for the Buddha. That is one of the explanations for an Arahan, is that the one who has no secrets. Bhante Vimal Ramsey also used to like this explanation of an Arahan, the one who has no coverings, means here is nothing he has to cover. Eravana, the Naga king, came into your presence when he heard you are the conqueror. Having consulted with you, he departed saying, excellent, delighted to have heard your words. So he's kind of praising the Buddha, saying that there are other beings also who have come and consulted the Buddha. King Vesavari Kuvara also approached you. inquiring about the Dhamma. When questioned, you answered him, O wise one, and he too, having listened, was delighted. So, the earthbound Devas have come, the earthbound king, the earthly king has come and consulted you. Adherents of other sects given to debate, whether Ajivikas or Nigantas, also all fail to overtake you in wisdom, as one standing cannot overtake one walking swiftly. So there are certain groups of people in Buddha's time. They were kind of doing debates, and they were kind of engaging in kind of verbal arguments to kind of prove that they are right. So those will not be able to gain wisdom. That is what this lay follower is telling or kind of pointing it out. And in this Sutta Nibbata, there is a lot of emphasis on not to argue, not to debate, and to kind of practice. And this is considered to be, Sutta Nibbata is to be considered one of the oldest collection of suttas. Even in the time of the Buddha, they used to praise monks, saying that this monk has kind of by-hearted the Sutta Nibbata. So it was mentioned in suttas also, this collection of suttas. So it is considered to be the one of the oldest suttas. And this sutta also has some of the most strictest instructions for the monks, how to kind of live a ascetic life. These Brahmins given to debate, also some who are elder Brahmins, are all dependent on you for the meaning, as are others who think themselves debaters. So even the Brahmins come for the meaning of certain things. And we see there are many suttas where the Brahmin have come and clarified points. For this Dhamma, subtle and blissful, has been well proclaimed by you, O Blessed One. All wish to hear that alone. When asked, declare it to us, Supreme Buddha. So he's asking that the Dhamma which is there is subtle and blissful, and all wish to hear what you want to, what you are going to say. All these bhikkhus sitting together and lay followers as well wish to hear it. Let them hear the Dhamma realized by the stainless one, as the Devas listen to Vasava's well-spoken word. Vasava is the Saka, or Indra. It is in India, it is known as Indra. So he is the king of the Devas. So he, how the Devas listen to him, we will listen to you with attention. That is what the lay Brahmin is telling him. So now what the lay Brahmin has asked is to talk about two things, about the monks and the lay people. So first the Buddha will talk about the monks. Listen to me, bhikkhus. I will proclaim to you the cleansing Dhamma. All retain it in mind. A thoughtful person seeing the good should adapt that deportation proper for a monk. A bhikkhu should not wander at the wrong time, but at the proper time he should walk to the village for alms. For ties stick to one given to untimely wandering. Hence the Buddhas do not wander at the wrong time. So in Vinaya rules also, there are rules where if the monk has to go to the village, it has to go in a proper time. One of the proper times is in the morning, he should not go unless the sun has illuminated the surrounding. That means that when you look at a tree, you can see apart the two leaves of the tree. So the outline of the leaves can be easily seen. So that is the time where the sun has arisen and there is light around. So that is one time the bhikkhu can go for the alms round. Then the other time he cannot go is in the afternoon. If he has to go in the afternoon, he has to take the permission of the chief monk and then go. And the other time is after sundown. After sundown, there are many problems you can face. In one of the suttas, that is the reason given not to go, are a lot of reasons have been given. And thus the reason for not having the nighttime meal also, that you don't have to go out and wander because there are many problems a bhikkhu can face. So that is the reason the proper time has been given for going out, and they should not wander around whatever time they want to. Forms and sounds, tastes and odors, and tactile objects drive beings mad. Having removed desire for these things at the proper time, one should enter for the morning meal. So one should keep their senses under control and ensure that they are not swayed by the sense doors. So when you are keeping all these things in mind, and when you are going to the arms round, then you are not kind of caught up in the samsaric things which are available out there. Then, having obtained alms on the occasion, having returned alone, one should sit down in seclusion, reflecting inwardly. One should not let one's mind wander outside, but should keep oneself collected. So, what the Buddha is saying is, once you have obtained the food for the day, then you come back and do your meditation, you do your bhavana, you do your contemplation. And the word collected has been used over here. Should keep oneself collected. So this is what the Bhante Vimalaramsi also likes this word, is collectedness. So your mind is collected and put on a object of meditation, and it is inwardly focused. So then if your mind runs around for something which is happening outside, you can 6 hour, as we say, we are saying right effort as 6 hour, saying recognize, release, relax, re-smile, return, and repeat when needed. So your mind goes out, then you bring it back and keep it collected. So you are able to see what is happening, how your mind's attention is moving, and how it is impersonal. If he should converse with a disciple or with anyone else or with a bhikkhu, he should speak about the sublime Dhamma. He should not slander or criticize others. So when he is speaking, he should speak about Dhamma. He should not speak about many things. Then there are other suttas also where Buddha is kind of giving a list of things the bhikkhu is not supposed to speak about. Like he is not supposed to speak about politics. He is not supposed to speak about wars. He is not supposed to speak about the princes. And there is a lot of list has been given. So he has to keep his words and thoughts towards the Dhamma. For some contend in debate, but we do not praise those of slight wisdom. Ties from here and there stick to them, or they send their minds far away. So when we debate, there are many things which happens. In Sutta Nipata itself, there are mentions about what happens to the mind when one debates. So one, if he wins, he gets ego, that I have won. And if he loses, he kind of gets despair that I have lost. And then there are other things like he has a tendency to lie to kind of just prove his point. When he speaks about certain things where he has no conviction of those things. So there are many kind of pitfalls hindrances which kind of arise when you are doing debates. And then you will not be able to kind of develop your wisdom also. Alms, a dwelling with bed and seat, water to wash the dirt from his cloak. Having heard the Dhamma taught by the fortunate man, a disciple of the one of excellent wisdom. One of excellent wisdom is the Buddha. Should use them reflectively. Use them reflectively means you have to think about it, then use it. Like there is a chant or a reflection which is there that is translated in English also. Like before meals, this is the alms food I am eating, not for fun, not for pleasure, not for fattening, not for intoxication, only for the maintenance and continuance of the body, to keeping it healthy, to helping with the holy life. Thinking thus, I will allay my hunger without overeating, so that I may continue to live blamelessly and at ease. So that is a reflection one does for the food. And that same way, there is a reflection for the robes, there's a reflection for the dwelling, and there is a reflection for the medicinal requisites. Medicinal requisites are like tea, coffee, juice, which bhikkhu can have after the midday meal when he kind of feels hunger. So he can have those things after that. So he has to reflect on that also. And over here, only the mention of two things have been done is dwelling and food. So later on, Buddha has kind of expanded on it, because this also kind of gives an indication that this is a very old or early teachings of the Buddha. For in regard to alms food, a lodging, and water to wash the dirt from his cloak, a bhikkhu will not cling to these things, as the water does not cling to a lotus leaf. So there is no attachment he develops towards the food, because it's just for the maintenance of the body. He has the food to live the holy life. And then if he has to live, he has to just live to kind of protect himself from the flies, protect himself from the heat, protect himself from the wind. So all these things are the only reason why he dwells. So he does not develop attachment. For in now, let me tell you the householder's duty. So now, Buddha was talking about the bhikkhus. Now he will be talking about the lay people. Now let me tell you the householder's duty. How one should act to become a good disciple. For this entire duty of bhikkhu cannot be carried out by one with possessions. One with possessions means they have a house, property, business. So one with possessions will not be able to kind of fully do this activity. So thus, Buddha is saying that he will give instructions separately. Having put down the rod towards all beings. Rod means the lathi, we call in India, which is the stick. All beings, towards all beings, towards those in the world, both firm and frail. One should not kill living beings or cause to kill, nor should one approve of others to kill. So first order of business is that they should not have any kind of violence. So violence should be stopped. That is also the first precept, is about not to kill. Next, a disciple should not knowingly take anything not given anywhere. One should not cause stealing or approve of theft. One should entirely avoid taking anything not given. So that is the second precept, which is for the not to steal. A wise person should avoid impure conduct as one would avoid a blazing pit of coals. But if one is incapable of the celibate life, one should not transgress with others' spouse. So Buddha is also advising the lay people. It is interesting over here that he's advising lay people that if possible, be celibate. And if you are not, then be faithful to your wife. You should not kind of do, commit adultery. And in one of the suttas, Buddha also explains about the Brahmins of the past who were rishis, and they used to stay celibate. But there were certain rishis who used to have wives, but they used to only kind of have a relationship with the wife until they had their first son. And after that, the wife and the husband used to stay the whole life as with celibacy. So this has been kind of praised by the Buddha, that even in lay life, you should not overindulge or be kind of obsessed with that. So that advice has been given. And anyways, I told you that Sutta Nipata, the advice which has been given is more stricter than any other kind of sutta collections. One who has entered a council or an assembly should not speak falsely to anyone. One should not make others lie or approve of false speech one should entirely avoid speaking untruth. So one should not speak untruth, but one should also not encourage others to speak untruth or not approve of others being untruthful. So this has been an important kind of message. And then the false speech which is there. The false speech also includes one should not kind of curse. One should not use words like gossip. One should not kind of cause fights between two groups of people. So that also comes into the false speech. A householder who espouses this dhamma should not indulge in intoxicating drink. He should not make others drink or approve of drinking, having understood that this ends in madness. So the Buddha is saying that you should not drink, not encourage others to drink, because the drinking can lead to madness. Madness means that you will do things which you will normally not do. That will lead to other things. There was a kind of a small story or which was spoken in humor, but it is about Mara coming to a wealthy merchant, and he has a wife who is very devoted and a servant who is kind of very loyal. And the Mara comes and says that you have to beat your wife and I'll make you the king of this area. And he says, no, I cannot beat my wife. I love my wife. And she is very respectful to me. He says, then kill your servant. The merchant says, no, I cannot kill my servant because he is very loyal. Then the Mara says, just drink a little bit of wine. I'll give you alcohol. You drink the alcohol and that would be enough. So he said, okay, alcohol, I'm not hurting anybody. So I'll have the alcohol. So he has the alcohol and the wife becomes irritated and says, you are such a pious man. Why are you having alcohol? You should not indulge in such things. And he becomes angry because of the alcohol. He has no control over his mind. So he starts beating his wife. When he starts beating his wife, his loyal servant sees that and tries to protect the mistress of the house. So he tries to protect, and then this man gets so angry that why are you coming between myself and my wife? And he kills the servant. So that is a kind of a way of showing that it does not help you kind of control yourself. So you lose your control and you do things which are kind of not in the normal course of things you will not do. That is madness. One other sutta is there in the Vinaya where how the rule of not drinking came for the monks. There was a monk who was good in psychic powers. So once he went to a kuti and there was a naga who was harassing people. So he came to fight with the monk. The monk very easily defeated the naga. And it is very similar story to the story of Krishna going into the lake and the seven-headed snake he kind of captures and tames. So this is the same story which is there of this monk. And then after that, the village people become very happy with the monk and say, what is your favorite drink? We'll have that. So he says, a drink which is a little bit of alcoholic. It is like a beer. So it was not kind of, nobody was avoiding that. It was, it had alcohol content in it. So he goes around the houses and every household gives him a glass of that drink. So because he has such a huge volume of that drink, he becomes totally intoxicated. And he goes to the, and when he goes to his kuti, he finds that the Buddha is there with other monks and he wants to prostrate to the Buddha. He wants to pay his respect to the Buddha. So he is so intoxicated that he does not know which direction it is there. And he, where the Buddha is not there, he starts kind of paying his respects and prostrating over there. And the Buddha says that, see, this was a mighty monk who yesterday conquered a naga. And today he does not know which direction to prostrate or pay respects. So that is how the drinking of alcohol kind of makes you lose control and leads to madness. That is what the Buddha is saying. So now this is sounding like a repeat, but just listen to this, what the Buddha is. This is also talking about the lay people. One should not kill living beings or take what is not given. One should not speak falsely or drink intoxicant. One should abstain from sex. Over here it is abstain from sex. From impure conduct, one should not eat at night. It is also saying not to eat at night. And outside the prescribed time. Prescribed time is till noon one can eat. And after that, you should not eat. One should not wear garlands, apply perfumes. One should sleep on a bed or a mat on the ground. For this, they say, is the eightfold upasata observance taught by the Buddha, who has reached the end of suffering. So now the Buddha is giving instructions to the lay people that how you can conduct the upasata with eight precepts. So over here, he's explaining about the eight precepts. Hence, confident in mind, having observed the upasata complete with its eight factors on the 14th, 15th, and 8th of the fortnight and during special period. So the full moon, new moon, and the 8th day between full moon and new moon. So there is 14 days, 15 days, and 8 days. That are the periods which is saying. So in a month, it would be a total four occasions. The Buddha is kind of asking them to kind of observe the upasata. When I was in Wat Pa Nanachat in Thailand, they used to observe this without fail, and lay people used to also come, and they used to also do one thing, which was they used to stay up all night and do meditation without sleeping. So that was done every 8 days, 7 days, 8 days. It will happen regularly. So in a month, there will be four occasions where you would stay awake the whole night and do meditation. So that was an interesting experience, because the next day you have to get up and do your arms round. Next day you have to do your chores and all these things. Arms round, definitely you are not sleeping, so you directly go for the arms round. Then you have to clean the monastery. Then you have to go for a meeting. So you have no big chunk of time to kind of sleep the whole day. How important it is observe upasata for lay people? What happens if you don't? There is nothing which happens which you don't do it. But how important it is, it will be in the next two verses, you will know. So the Buddha is saying that in the morning, the wise person who has observed the upasata, rejoicing with a confident mind, should distribute food and drink to the bhikkhu sangha in a fitting way. So he does upasata and also does sangadana. One should righteously support mother and father. One should engage in righteous business. So supporting mother and father has been mentioned many times in the suttas. Buddha says that even if like someone who kind of carried their mother and blind mother and father throughout India to the auspicious places, if one does that for 100 years and they have to take care of their mother and father, still the debt which is owed by the mother and father cannot be repaid. So that is the importance of mother and father, and they have to be taken care of. That has been repeatedly mentioned by the Buddha. One should engage in righteous business. Righteous business are business which are not related to guns, which are not related to animals, which are not related to poison, which are not related to slave trade. So those things are not good businesses. So one should not indulge in that, and one should indulge in righteous business. Trading is one of the things is righteous, and when Bodhisattva had a lot of Buddha told about Bodhisattva story, many of the stories, Bodhisattva was a merchant. The merchant trade of buying somewhere and selling something for a profit is considered righteous. A heedful layperson observing this practice reaches the devas, self called self-luminous. So when he stays in this way, a heedful layperson observing this practice reaches the devas called self-luminous. That is Suddha Vasa Devas. Suddha Vasa Devas are the devas which live in the non-return realm. So one becomes a non-returner. So one becomes an anagami by following the advice, by doing the Uposatha. And in one other sutta, which was just focused on the Uposatha, that also says that if one does not do any other thing, but observes the Uposatha, then one becomes a non-returner. Over here, the Buddha is talking about Suddha Vasa Devas. So there is one small update for that, which was I found on the internet. So I'll just read that about the Suddha Vasa Devas. The Venerable Maha Moggallana often went on visits to Yama Devas, Tusita Devas, Nimmanarati Devas, the Parinimmanarati Devas, and the Devas of the Brahma world, including the Suddha Vasa Devas. He saw the Suddha Vasa Devas, how they were virtuous, mighty, long-lived, beautiful, enjoying great well-being. They are self-luminous, travel through the air, have pleasant food, live happily, and go wherever they wish. They are free from passion. They are Deva Arhants who win release in the middle of their sojourn, that is middle of their journey or middle of their short stay in heaven, are not subject to return to this world and are free from all association with the ignorant and average worldlings. So this is the praise of the Devas realm where you can read. So what happens when you, what is the importance of this is, that you get to become free from the samsaric cycles and live in the Brahma Deva before your final release. So that is the importance of that. If you don't do it, whatever is happening will happen. It is a cause and effect chain, and the cause and effect chain will go out. If you do good, good will happen. If you do bad, bad will happen. But whenever a person does good, and has kind of benefits of that, then one's mind is also changed. Like one of the stories of Bodhisattva was that he was born in a king's palace. And as an infant, he kind of had the realization that he was a Bodhisattva. And he was born in a king's palace. And he realized that when he becomes the king, he will have to melt out justice. He'll have to give orders to kill people. He has to give the orders to kind of hurt people. He will have to kind of confiscate land. He will have to go and fight wars. So he thought that that things will lead to hell. So what happens is then if you do good things and charity and everything, you are born in a Deva realm. When you are born in a Deva realm, when you are born in a rich family. You are born as a king's family. You are born in an influential family. When you look at those people, they have a lot of ego. They kind of hurt people. They do wrong things. And because they are not careful, then they can again fall into the samsaric cycle of going into hell. And again, it takes a long time for a person who has gone to hell again to gain a human birth. So this is a cycle which kind of goes on and on. So nothing happens in that sense that if somebody keeps doing good, so like there's Bill Gates. He is the world's, he was world's richest person. Then he said that I will do charity. There are certain people who say that he's doing charity for tax purposes or whatever the concepts are. But he does charity. He gives billions of dollars to cure, I think, malaria. He has given billions of dollars to this COVID vaccine. he has given a lot of money to different kind of charities which has helped humanity. So he was in a good position. He had a wealth and he has given to charity. So next birth which is there is also supposed to be good for him. So this cycle of good can also go on for many, many times. The cycle of worst to worst can also go on for many, many lifetimes. So this samsara can keep on going. But if you observe Buddha's teaching and follow his instructions, then the possibility of release from this samsara is there. So he is promising that you may become anagami. And if you only practice, say, the five precepts diligently and contemplate on Buddha Dhamma Sangha, that is a minimum of following the Dhamma. Contemplate on itipiso. Itipiso is not just chanting. Contemplation means with meaning you read the words and think about those words. If you do these two things, Buddha says that you can declare yourself a sotapanna. So that is also the benefit of following the Buddha's teaching. So that is the reading of the sutta has ended. So is there any questions regarding the sutta? I that is good that you asked a question. Any other questions? Any has any question regarding any other topic also, like meditation or a general question also can ask. Was there something which was not clarified?
Can you please repeat night time, throughout the night people used to sit for meditation?
Yeah,
in so a month four times. Repeat,
so that was when I was living in Vatpananachat. I stayed for 1.5 years in Vatpananachat in Thailand, in a monastery. So in that monastery, if you are a lay person, if you are a pakao, which is said a white clothes person, so you are called an anagami. And then you are a samanera or you are a bhikkhu monk. Everybody, and including the lay people from the villages, used to come and stay in the monastery for the whole night. And they used to have a Dhamma talk, one extra Dhamma talk was there. Then they used to kind of spend the whole night in meditation. And they used to follow the 8 precepts. So they will have lunch, and after that lunch, nobody will have lunch, but they used to have very, very generous drinks. So they would have coffee, tea, cocoa, then they would have chocolates. At least the monks, they used to give chocolates. Then there were certain allowable foods, which are ginger. They are candy ginger. So they put ginger in sugar and they make ginger candy. They are good for digestion. They are considered medicine. So medicine can be had in the evening time. So they used to have a lot of things which are called allowable foods. So they used to have generously those things, and they used to give generously to the monks also. But we were not supposed to sleep. So the whole thing would start by the day of the Uposatha, where we used to stay awake. The day used to start with the cleaning. We go for the alms round, have a meal, everything. Then we clean the whole monastery. Then in the evening, we sit at 6:30, we start. And we sit the whole night. We have a break for tea. Again, there is one extra tea in the middle of the night. So coffee and certain things we used to have, coffee, cocoa. Then after that, the whole the next day, we had to do certain things like go for the alms round, come back, have meal. Then again, we used to kind of rest for some time. Then there was a washing day. So we had to wash and clean the monastery. Then there was a group meeting. So again, we used to come in the evening, have a group, all the monks used to have tea together. So this was the whole day. And then This was 3 days in a row. The next day we used to come and clean the shala, the main hall. So that cleaning was to be done. So that was a 3 day period. In every 8 days, these 3 day periods were dedicated to this activities. So every 8 days or 7 days, we used to stay awake.
That means you are with the Sumedho sect, Sumedho monastery.
The Vatpananaka was established by Ajahn Sumedho. Yes.
Ajahn. Thank you.
Okay. Is there any other questions? General questions are also okay. So if everything people have understood, then we can close this meeting. Yeah, Shubham. Yes.
Vandami Bhante. Bhante, actually I was outside when you said something about the Uposat.
Correct. So Uposatha is...
Can you please repeat that?
So Uposatha is there on new moon day and
Ashtami. Ashtami so, and one day before full moon and new moon.
But there are 8 days between that also. So there
yeah,
are...
Yeah, that is called Ashtami.
Huh?
Ashtami, that is called Ashtami.
Ashtami. So so I am not aware of those terms. So in that period, that every 7 to 8 days period, that is a Uposatha day. You can you can follow where you have to keep 8 precepts. The precepts additional than the 4 precepts. In the 5 precepts, the third precept for Abrahmacharya. Not Kamesumichatara, but Abrahmacharya, that is to abstain from all sexual activity. Then there are three precepts which are for food, for perfumes and all the garments and everything. And then the last is for sleeping. So these are the 8 precepts a person keeps. And one other thing he does is after the Uposatha, he gives Sangadana, means gives food to the Sangha. So that is the activity if he does, then it is considered that one can be a Anagami. So that has been explained by the Buddha. And here it has been explained, and it has been explained in many other suttas also.
Okay, thank you so much, Bhante. Thank you.
So I'm just reading this. Does Buddha ask lay followers to abstain from sex if they can? If they can't, that seems okay too. Is he just saying that being chaste is better? Yes, he's saying that abstaining from sexual activity is better. Also leads to a lot of mind wandering. And it was also a part of the Vedic tradition also in the ancient times where the Vedic rishis used to marry. And when the first son was born, they used to, after that, they used to follow Brahmacharya. I think this has been mentioned in one of those popular books also. I think the man who sold Ferrari or something like that. I read some few pages of that. And that also has been mentioned in that thing. That was the tradition. So Buddha is praising that. But Buddha is also recognizing that it is not possible for everybody to do that. So if you are not, then be loyal to your wife. One other thing is about... Shila is that Buddha says that the holy life is not lived for the perfection of Shila. Shila is important. The following of precepts is important, but holy life is not lived for following the precepts, but to develop wisdom. So to develop wisdom, there is a in-between path of concentration or collected mind, where that was mentioned. So that collected mind also has to be developed so that wisdom has to can be developed. So one keeps the precepts and develops a collected mind, and then develops wisdom. When the wisdom is developed, there is knowledge and vision. That time the person can kind of transcend this whole samsara, because he has understood how it is functioning. The sutta mentioned next morning is smiling mind. So what Dr. Madhusudan ji is pointing out is that when I think what he's saying is that when something is done with a smiling mind, okay, a confident rejoicing with confidence mind. So he's saying that that when a mind is smiling and that is there, then whatever you are doing is fulfilled. So when he, one gives dana also, one gives it with a smiling mind. So that is something, a good point Dr. Madhusudan ji is pointing out. So, and he is happy also because of the good merits one has earned. So there is joy which comes to the mind. So any other questions? I think everybody has got it. So we'll share merits. And after that, we kind of, on your own time, please do send metta to Sister Khema, Mataji Khema. She is in hospital, but not a bad situation. She is speaking now and again when she gets Wi-Fi. I speak to her in a day at least once, and she sounds normal. Today, at least, she was much better, because yesterday she got a blood transfusion. So I think that helped, blood transfusion. So today she was sounding much better, and we have postponed her trip also, and that also happened very well without any problem. So just send her some metta, and with this sharing also, we are sharing for her. May suffering ones be suffering free, and the fear struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief, and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we have thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty power, share this merit of ours. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensation. Sadhu, sadhu.
Thank you, Bhante.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm looking for the recording. Okay, stop.